Okay. I think we can try to get started. So thank you for attending. And this is probably the last talk for the second last talk for the whole DataWorks Summit. So thanks for coming. And I am Zheng Xiao. I'm a software engineer from Uber. So today, I'd like to share some of our Uber experience about how we run Presto and Parquet at scale. I know there are here and there are news about Uber. So for this talk, I do not have more news about Uber, but I'd like to share some of the technical details. So how our Uber employee, we see our work and how it's going. You might slightly get a clear and a different point of view. So the agenda is first about talking about our mission, both for the Uber and also for our team. And then a brief introduction of our Uber's business highlights. You will see the business really going well. And then about our analytics infrastructure at Uber, all the components and the big picture. Then comes to the details about what is Presto, why we choose Presto, and some of the Presto technical details. And then about Parquet, brief introduction about what is a columnar storage, how Parquet performs in the whole picture. And then the optimizations we did for the Parquet optimizations inside Presto. And finally, I will share some of our roadmap, both for the Presto and also for the whole team. So the number one, Uber mission is making transportation as reliable as running water everywhere and for everyone. To make that happen, here's some of the stats about Uber. We are already running business over six continents, and we are running over 70 countries, more than, I think, almost 500 cities. And internally, we have over 12,000 employees and still growing. And for the trips, average trips per day is more than 10 million trips, still growing. And for monthly active riders, over 40 million, and the monthly active drivers, over 1.5 million. So all these numbers, I think our company already shared, published some of our data over the, our revenue data over the web. So you can search and you can see we are really doing pretty good in Q1 this year, as well as the previous years. So come back to the technical. Here is our analytics infrastructure at Uber. And all the data things happens here. From left-hand side to the right, we have three data sources. One is the Kafka topics. All the event logs are happening there. We are also having the schema list, which is our in-house built key value store on top of MySQL. So we have a blog post about how we make it at Uber. And we are also dumping that schema list data into Hadoop periodically. And internally, we are also using MySQL and Postgres and many other relational databases. We are dumping that into Hadoop as well. So all these three data sources are finally dumping into Hadoop. And during the dumping, we may run some streaming SQL analytics. For example, we are running Pinot and Flink for the streaming analytics. We are also running the real-time SQL on the, we load the data into MemSQL and running that as well. And finally, all this data start in our Hadoop data lake, which has all the data. We name them two parts. One is we call the raw data. I will explain what is raw data, what is model data, table. Another one is after we run in ETLs, we get the model tables, which are the, you can think of as of that as a ETL processing. After the processing, we have all the model tables. And this table are available to all our query engines, including Hive, Presto, and Spark. So currently, Spark and Hive is mostly using for ETLs, and Presto mostly using for the ad hoc queries. So after doing these, we also have a pipeline to load the Hadoop data into a data warehouse, non-open source. We buy some license from some other company, loading that into the warehouse, and the user can also run query directly on this data warehouse. On top of that, we are supporting a bunch of use cases, including the real-time applications and the machine learning jobs. There are reports and dashboards everywhere, and there are notebooks. You can either have a notebook connecting directly into Presto or Spark to run your job, and they are ad hoc queries, and we are supporting BI tools as well. And one other thing we are doing now is, number one, security, since Uber really have the user-sensitive data. So we are running a secure, our big data running in a secure mode. One other thing is we are building more and more data centers, and Uber is one of the few companies having multiple data centers running all the big data, and we are supporting all actives across all the data centers. We're also having chargeback and observability for all these clusters. So here's for our data. We have two kinds of data, and the data format is in Parquet, which is a columnar format. I will cover the details. And for the raw tables, what are raw tables? These tables are no pre-processing. They just come in and we dump them onto HDFS, and they are highly nested. Highly nested means it is very usual in Uber. You can see the up to 30 levels of nesting. You can have an array of structs, of maps, of structs, of arrays, and et cetera, et cetera. This is highly nested. And even for each of the structs, you may have over 80 or 100 fields inside them. So I will give an example in our optimization. And for these raw tables, there's very fast ingestion. After 30 minutes, the event happens, we get the data. But these tables are really huge and nested and no cleaning at all. And one other type of table is that we call it model tables. We are running high ETL to clean the data, and we have the pre-processing. After getting that, all the model tables are flattened, so there's no struct or array or anything. They are just double or long or timestamp, the primitive data types. But these are a little bit longer. We need to wait for a few hours, and could be as bad as 12 hours. But these are for really good performance. So after getting the data, we can take a look at our Presto deployment. At Uber, we have two clusters. One is we call it application cluster. This is just for the very time sensitive use cases. And it has hundreds of machines, and it's serving over 100K queries per day. And the P90 for these, all the queries running on this cluster is 30 seconds. So it's really very fast queries. Another one we call the ad hoc cluster, which is just for anyone at Uber. You can, whenever you are shooting query at Presto, you are hitting this one. It's shared by all the users. Still have hundreds of machines, and we are serving over 20K queries per day, but these queries are more expensive. The P90 for this cluster is 60 seconds, still within 1 minute. And Presto provides access to both raw and model tables. Altogether, we have over 5 petabytes of data. And the data, I think this number is still so obsolete. We are still growing, and data is really huge. But to be conservative, we can say 5 petabytes of data. So totally, Presto is serving over 120K queries per day. Here are the applications we are supporting internally as Uber. Number one is marketplace pricing. We want to compute the real-time driver incentives, and these are supported running on Presto. Also, communication platform. For example, if we see a driver whose rating is below 5, we try to disable that. And this is running in SQL and running on Presto. Also, we are tracking the driver quality and action, a number of things like that. Also, the growth marketing, we are supporting BI tools, for example, Looker, running on Presto. And also, data scientists are running exploratory analytics using notebooks or some other tools running on Presto. Also, the data quality check, including the ETL and some other things, we want to check whether the data is fresh. That is also running on Presto, and so many other ad hoc queries, which we really do not know what they are running on, but there are so many of them. So what is Presto? This is a brief introduction. So Presto is an interactive SQL engine for big data. A number of features. The first one is Presto is interactive query speeds. Presto is really fast. It is started by Facebook, and fundamental of the coding, if you take a look at the code, and if you just try it, you will be surprised. It is really fast, and you will like it. So the number one good thing is performance speed. The second thing is scale, horizontally scalable. So Presto running on commodity hardware, you do not need to buy any special expensive hardware. You just buy get commodity one, and you can install Presto and just let it run. And then, so there's no reboot or any special installation. You just, whenever you have a running 300 node cluster, you can add another 200 machine, and then it becomes a 500 node cluster. So it's easy plug-in. And Presto supports standard ANSI SQL. I think everyone very familiar with SQL. So this is a standard access layer. And it is battle tested by Facebook, Uber, Netflix. And as far as I know, LinkedIn, Twitter, and so many other companies, Airbnb, all of these major vendors are using Presto. And Facebook is the creator of Presto. And they build all the foundation very nice. And Uber, I think we are second only to Facebook for the deployment, as well as the business. Are we? Yeah. And also, so many vendors like the Teradata and Amazon, they are selling Presto. Amazon has Amazon Athena, which is backed by Presto. And Teradata also selling, have their own enterprise-ready Presto. So Presto is completely open source. And you can check the code and review the code there. And Presto can access to petabytes of data in the Hadoop data lake. One other interesting feature, which I will cover later, is even other than Hadoop, Presto can even run SQL on top of that. OK. Here's more detail about the technical, how Presto works internally. Standard SQL stuff, you have the Presto client, send a SQL query. And inside each Presto cluster, you have one coordinator. And all the others are workers. The coordinator got the SQL and do the analyzing. You got the AST. And then you got the planner, got a logical plan. And then we are doing the rule-based optimization for the plan. Finally, we got the optimized query plan. And then there's a fragmenter which will chunk the plan into fragments. Inside each of the fragments, the task can be parallel executed. And then all these tasks will get scheduled by the scheduler. And scheduler is keeping the node membership, and also for each of task is keeping track of how these tasks are going, what is the progress on each of the workers. And then each of worker is just running the task. Some of them may be doing a table scan some table from Hadoop, or somewhere else. Or some of the worker, they are doing aggregation or some other analytics functions. And finally, we got the data, and we got the result, and we stream that back to the client. So why Presto is fast? A number of reasons. Number one is that data is in memory during execution. Unlike MapReduce, between each of the steps, you need to spill the result, intermediate result, onto HDFS. And then you read it back again in the following MapReduce jobs. Presto doesn't do that. All the execution is in memory. So this is one of the reasons why Presto is faster. Another one is pipelining and streaming. So unlike Hive or some other engines, they are doing a push-based model, which means you ask me to scan all the files. I scan them, I'm done, and then I push this result to the upper level operator. But Presto doesn't do this way. Presto is a pool-based model. I'm the final result. I'm asking for the limit five, the top five results. And I'm pulling the result from the lower base operator. So when you are running Presto queries, you will see the extremely fast speed when you are doing limit query. If you are doing some drawings or something, limit 5 or limit 10, this is a typical use case. This will be super fast in Presto, since it is pool-based. Another one is a columnar storage and execution. So Presto supports both ORC and Parquet. Both of them are columnar storage. But in addition to that, the internal engine of Presto is also columnar. So when Presto internally executing the data blocks, they are building the columnar blocks, and the engine will process all these columnar blocks. So not only column storage, but also execution. This is very fast. And the final thing is about bytecode generation. Recently, the Spark community is also doing similar things, and Presto community already have that for almost all the operators, including the inline virtual function calls and rewrite inner loops. So whenever you have a huge for loop and you have a switch to track each of the value type, and in database, you already know the type before you scan the file. So you can rewrite that into a simple simple shift or some other operations. So all these bytecode generation is, I would say, is very solid, and we didn't see any problem when we are running this for bytecode. So all the things, I think Spark and Impala, they are trying to do similar things, but Presto is really getting this in production quality. The following thing about resource management, I think everyone will be interested whether we are running Presto on Yarn or Mesos. The answer is no. Presto has its own resource manager. It is not on Yarn, not on Mesos. And for CPU management, Presto internally have priority queues. So all the tasks are sharing the CPU time. And whenever your query is running within 2 minutes, you are always trying to get as much CPU time for you as possible. And there's some other depriority queues from 2 minutes to 5 minutes and longer than 10 minutes. So the short running query will always run very fast. And the long running queries will get slower and slower. This is how Presto manages CPU. And for the memory management, Presto has several caps since we keep all the data inside memory, so we have caps. For example, the max memory per query per node, there's a cap for that. And if your query, what if your query exceeds that cap? Your query will fail with a message saying there's not enough memory for your query. But process will not fail. There's no out of memory, and the Presto process will continue serving the other traffic. Just the query that requires more memory will fail. And these are the limitations for Presto. Number one is no fault tolerant. So if during your query execution, any of the machine is down or anything bad happens, or the, for example, the network partitioning happens, your query will fail. So the user have to retry their query. But from our experience, I think our user is like Presto so much, so they didn't complain much. They just automatically, they retry themselves. One other thing is the join do not fit in memory, as we have the memory cap. So some of the huge joins, if you are joining two huge tables, your query may fail, but there's no OOM for Presto process. The process still standing there serving the other traffic. At the same time, we might get a complaint, or we will tell the user try this query on Hive. So Hive is like a backend for running expensive queries. One other thing is from the design point of view, we will see that there's only one coordinator in the cluster. If the coordinator have anything bad, and then the whole cluster is not functioning well. So coordinator is really a single point of failure. That is theoretical. From practically, we didn't see that happens. Maybe our machine is so reliable, or we already built a matrix monitoring so many things. So theoretically, it is a single point of failure, but we didn't see much problem for this. Okay, and one nice feature for Presto is Presto connectors. I think in the big data field, one of the key ideas is do not copy data. Copy data is really expensive. And recently, Amazon have a new feature. You can call a truck and take your hard drive and then put that into some data center. So it's really expensive. And one of the nice design for Presto is we have the Presto connectors, which allow you to run SQL on any of the data sources. So one of the most popular one is Presto Hadoop connector, which we are using Presto to query the Hadoop data. But Presto can also be used to query a number of other things. For example, you can run Presto MySQL, querying the MySQL connector, querying Postgres. These are the simple things since they are also relational database. But Presto can also run SQL on Kafka, Cassandra, Redis, MongoDB, and so many other things. And to enable a new Presto connector for any data source, you just need to implement 3 or 4 APIs. It's very simple to do. And currently, we are investing whether we can run SQL on Elasticsearch. That is one of our Uber needs. OK, then let's talk about Parquet. So Parquet is a columnar storage for big data. And the basic idea about columnar storage is we try to store all the data within one column together. So when you are doing a projection or filter, we only get the necessary data. That's the basic idea. And Parquet is an open source project for that. For each of the Parquet file, we first cut it horizontally. Then we get different row groups. And within each row group, we chunk it vertically. So we have a number of column trunks inside the row group. Each of the column trunks just contain the value for that column. And each of the row group can contain multiple column values. And then at the end of the parquet file, there's always a parquet footer, which has all the metadata, including the for the row group level, we have the min max and how many nulls inside here, how many rows inside this column trunk. Yeah, almost all of our data is storing in parquet format. So we were doing many parquet optimizations for Presto. This is for the whole second half of last year and Q1 in this year. I will show you by one example, how can we optimize that. Here's an example query. We do, actually, the SQL is trying to get all the drivers who has a chip in the city and has a chip on a specific date. So it's a select based on driver UUID from a table where the data string is March the 2nd and the city ID is within one value. So the data, since we are having parquet data, number one is the for this table, it's shown a zillion chips. It has almost up to 15 levels of nesting. These array of structs of maps, so many of these. And within each struct, we may have more than 80 fields inside them. And also, these fields are frequently added, updated, inserted, and so many things happen. So why we are doing this complex data? Since we want the data ingestion to be as fast as possible. So we make that part easier, but then for the query engine part, we need to deal with this part of data. So traditionally, how Presto Parquet Reader do this, implement this, three steps from the bottom to up. Number one, we need to read all the Parquet files, read all the necessary fields. But the one thing is, since this base has so many fields inside this, originally Presto has to read the whole base, which has, you can see the base has city ID, driver UUID, client UUID, status, vehicle ID, so many of them, up to 80 of these fields. We need to read them all. And then Presto transform these parquet rows into Presto columnar blocks. Since Presto engine is a columnar engine, but we are getting these rows by using the parquet API. Then we do the transformation. After getting this done, we do evaluate the predicates, whether this is equal to 12 or greater than 10, something like that. This is how originally Presto works. And the first idea we try to optimize is nested column pruning. We do not need all this based on vehicle ID or status. We just want to read the necessary data. So in this way, when we are reading from parquet, we only read the necessary data. We only read, in this case, based on driver UUID and based on city ID. That's all we need. All the other fields, we do not need them. So this saves a huge in IO. After getting this done, we are doing the similar things. We transform these parquet rows into the Presto columns, and then we evaluate the predicates on top of that. And then we are thinking we can even do better. Since when we are reading from a parquet, we can directly build columnar blocks for Presto. We do not need to first read them row by row, and then we build Presto columns. So we can build a columnar block on the fly. So we reduce the three steps into a two step. First, we read the required fields from parquet, and then we build the columnar blocks for Presto on the fly. After getting this done, we have the columnar blocks for Presto. Then we can evaluate predicates on these columnar blocks. So this now we have two steps. This also saves CPU. And we can even do better since parquet has all these stats. It has min, max, and count, and et cetera, all these things we didn't use that much. Then when we are scanning the parquet file, we can try to evaluate the predicate at the same time. So this way, when we are reading the parquet file, we will read the parquet footer to get the min and max of that. For example, in this query, we will read the row group max value. If the row group max value city ID is 10, but what the SQL is looking for is 12, if the max value is 10, there's no way for any of the value to become 12. So we can skip reading the whole row group. This is one other IO saving. So after getting this done, then we get only the possible values that can match the predicates. Then we build the Presto blocks. And Parquet also have the dictionary. So if your Parquet data is encoding in dictionary encoding, the first page could be having all the dictionary values for the whole column chart. So even if some of the min and max is possible to match the predicates, but still, when we read the whole dictionary value, we may find, oh, this row group doesn't have any value match the predicates. So the other thing we do is we first read the footer. We got the min and max. In this example, the max is 21, so it's possible it can match the predicate. But when we are reading the CTID dictionary, the first page, we see that all the possible values is 3, 5, 9, 14, 21. There's no 12 inside. So we can still skip reading this row group. This is super helpful if you are running a needle in a haystack query, when you are looking for just one driver UUID or one writer within a huge Parquet file. It will filter most of the other row groups. And we can be lazy. For example, in this query, the CTID is in the predicate, and we are looking for projections for the driver UUID. So traditionally, when we are reading Parquet, we tell them we need these two fields, and then we're reading them out of that. But the driver UUID is only needed if there's a CTID match. So we make the driver UUID a lazy block, which we didn't load at the first time. We only load the predicate fields. And then after getting that, if we see there's a match for the CTID, then we continue loading the driver ID for the necessary matches. So this is we call it lazy reads. And after getting all these optimizations, I will show some benchmarking results. All these optimizations are already in production for our Presto and the Parquet in our data warehouse. And we see huge performance improvements. Here's benchmarking queries, which can kind of represent what we gain for our production traffic. We see the red one is a new Parquet reader, and the old one is the blue one, the old Parquet reader, is always at least 2x faster than before, saving both IOs and CPUs. Yep, that is all our technical work. And here's our Presto ongoing work. Number one thing is geospatial query optimization. And Uber, because of our business, we have so many geospatial data, as the longitude, latitude, and all this. We have a huge need for these geospatial functions and queries. And we have users running SQL to analyze this data. So we are already doing some optimization, and we're continuing doing that. And also, we internally have a huge Elasticsearch deployment, and so many data are already there. And some of our users would like to run SQL on top of this Elasticsearch. And because of Presto has this nice connector interface, we are investing in a Presto Elasticsearch connector. So user can run SQL directly on Elasticsearch. No need to copy the data. Also, the multi-tenancy support. Now our queries traffic is really big, and it's very common to see, let's say, 50 queries running concurrently on one cluster. How can we make sure different teams, one bad team or one bad user, doesn't occupy the whole resource? We have to put some limit and cap for that team, and we need to make the user-to-team mapping and manage all these resources, both for CPUs and memory and other resources. And also, as we are building more and more data centers, we need to make Presto to be all active for all these data centers. We are also doing authentication and authorization. One effort is for the security side. One other effort is we try to do user impersonation. So when the user shoots a query, when Presto is scanning the HDFS, we try to let HDFS know who is scanning the file so that we know who is the bad user they are scanning lots of HDFS traffic. And also, the single point of failure for the coordinator, if our traffic continues growing like this, we have to do something with the coordinator and for the reliability. So we are planning for the HA for the coordinator. So this is for our Presto roadmap. And also for the whole Hadoop team, we call our team Hadoop Infrastructure and Analytics. we have so many interesting projects going on, including, for example, the HDFS side. We are investing in erasure encoding to save more disk space, and also tier storage. So we have the SSD, memory, disk standing within the same HDFS cluster. Also, for the different data centers, we are making effort to make Hadoop all active in all the data centers. And for the ETL part, we are investing in Hive on Spark. So traditionally, we are running some Hive on MapReduce, some Hive on TAS, and we try to run Hive on Spark. Also, Spark itself, we have so many users are using Spark to either run SQL or they run some other Scala jobs or any job they want. We also have a dedicated Spark team to invest in that. Also for data visualization, we already have some notebook support. We call it data science workbench, which the user is a very nice notebook UI for user, so they can run SQL or any job on Presto or Hive or Spark. And we are extending that. Also, we need more data visualization to see help user debugging and check their query status in our cluster. So that is all the roadmap. So you can see, although there are so many news about Uber, but internally, we have so many interesting projects. And our platform is growing. And our traffic, user, all the things are quite interesting. So from internal point of view, I think all the engineers are seeing a quite positive sign for the business. So yeah, I hope this talk will give you a better understanding of Uber and how it's going at Uber. Yeah, that is all about that. And make sure if you are interested in Uber or any of the things in Hadoop, you can send your resume to my manager or me, Abi. My manager, Abi, who's managing the whole Hadoop team, and his email is abhik@uber.com. abhik@uber.com. Yeah, and after you chatting with Abi, you will be more excited about joining Uber. So please do that. And our projects and the users, everything is growing so fast. So if you're interested, you send your resume and you will learn more about Uber. Thank you. Any questions? Okay.
So you mentioned that you have row tables and model tables. You flatten you're flattening the SQL tables to model tables. Mm-hmm. I don't know, is that automatic process or manual process? Also, how do you handle the schema?
Okay. So the question is about we have row table and model tables. And is that a manual process or that an automatic process? So the first question, I would say that automatic, since we have so many these ETL jobs running on the fly. Whenever a new row table coming in, we are running this ETL to get a flattened table. Another one is how can we deal with the schema evolution, right? Schema matching. The schema matching is when we have the flattened table, we have new tables, flattened schema. So there's no schema evolution on that side. For the row table, structs of arrays of structs, this kind of thing. So the schema evolution is really a big problem. So since the metastore schema and the file schema may be mismatching, and there are cases where you can continue query the data. For example, your file schema may have more fields than your metadata schema, and may have less. So if you have less fields than the metastore, Presto can just return nulls. If you can have more, maybe Presto is invisible to that data. So we put a big effort early last year, and we saw that. So now all this schema evolution is no problem at all. More questions?
Do you have any benchmark results against follow-on
market? Yeah, the question is, do we have any benchmarking showing the difference between Presto and Impala, and maybe Spark and some other thing, Pivotal? Yeah, the answer is we didn't do that for between Presto and Impala. We did benchmarking before we launched Presto and all this SQL, interactive SQL engine stuff. But when we are doing that, I think at that time, Impala is not so mature to finish all our benchmark queries. So, and also this nested query support. But now Impala may have better and better support. And also Spark SQL, we did some benchmarking. Based on Uber's data, we see the Presto is faster than Spark SQL. But that is still 1.5 years ago, so now Spark SQL, they may get better performance, but Presto also getting better and better performance. Yes? The question is why we choose Parquet over ORC. This is a good question. The answer is that is not chosen by me. That's when I joined Uber, we already have Parquet data. Yeah, so from a query engine point of view, our mission is to support all the columnar file formats as efficient as possible. And yeah, we have some analysis between ORC and Parquet, but since Uber's data is so huge, it's so difficult to convert them into one unified file format, but still most of our data is in Parquet. Yes?
You guys mentioned that you have some Presto Elasticsearch connector work going on. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have some planning, and now we just started that, and I hope by the end of this year, we will have something out.
Yeah. From PayPal, we just started working on the same connector as well. So
oh, yeah. Yeah, that's nice. We can collaborate. Yeah. Yeah. Really nice. Okay. More questions? Okay, then we are done. Thank you.